account, of course. It seems, according to some suggestions of Habermas, that one can distinguish three major types of techniques. Those which permit one to produce, to transform, to manipulate things. The techniques which permit one to use sign systems. Three, the techniques which permit one to determine the conduct of individuals, to impose certain wills on them, and to submit them to certain ends or objectives. That is to say, one, techniques of production, two, techniques of signification, three, techniques of domination. Of course, if one wants to study history of natural sciences, it is useful, if not necessary, to take into account techniques of production and semiotic techniques. But since my project was concerned with the knowledge of the subject, I thought that the techniques of domination were the most important, without any exclusion of the others. Analyzing experience of sexuality and history of experience of sexuality, I became more and more aware that there is in all societies, whatever they be, another type of techniques. Techniques which permit individuals to effect by their own means or with help of other people, to effect a certain number of operations on their own bodies, on their own souls, on their own thoughts, on their own conduct, and this in a manner so as to transform themselves, modify themselves, or to attain a certain state of perfection, of happiness, of purity, of supernatural power, and so on and so on. Let's call this kind of techniques, techniques or technologies of the self. I think that if one wants to analyze the genealogy of subjects in Western societies, he has to take into account not only techniques of domination, but also techniques of the self. Let's say he has to take into account the interaction between those two types of techniques, the points where the technologies of domination of individuals over one another have recourse to processes by which the individual acts upon himself, and conversely, the points where the techniques of the self are integrated into structures of coercition. The contact point, where are tied together the way individuals are driven and known by others, and the way they conduct themselves and know themselves, it is what we can call government. Governing people, in the broad meaning of the word, as they spoke, for instance, in the 16th century, of governing children, or governing a family, governing souls. Governing people is not a way to force people to do what the governor wants. It is always a versatile equilibrium with complementarity and conflicts between techniques which assure coercition and processes through which the self is constructed and modified by himself. When I was studying asylums, prisons, and so on, I insisted maybe too much on the techniques of domination. What we can call discipline is something really important in this kind of institutions. But it is only one aspect of the art of governing people in our societies. We must not understand the exercise of power as pure violence or strict coercition. Power consists in complex relations. These relations involve a set of rational techniques, and the efficiency of those techniques is due to the subtle intrication of coercition technologies and of the self technologies. I think we have to get rid of the more or less Freudian schema. You know, the schema of the interiorization of the law by the self. Fortunately, from a theoretical point of view, and maybe unfortunately from a practical point of view, things are much more complicated. In short, having studied the field of government by taking as point of departure techniques of domination, I would like, in years to come, to study the government, especially in the field of sexuality, starting from the techniques of the self. Among such techniques, those oriented towards the discovery and the formulation of the truth concerning oneself are extremely important. As if, for the government of people in our societies, everyone had not only to obey, but also to produce the truth about oneself. Self-examination, examination of conscience, and confession are among the most important of those procedures. I would like to show the transformation through those two procedures of the old Delphic precept, know yourself, gnotis euton, into the monastic precept, tell me each of your thoughts, omnes cogitationes. For this precept, born and developed first in monastic institutions, though this precept played, I think, a great role in the constitution of modern subjectivity. With this precept starts what we could call the hermeneutics of the self. This evening, I'll try to outline the way confession and self-examination were conceived in Greek and Latin philosophers. And tomorrow, I'll try to show you what they became in the early Christianity. The title of those two lectures could have been, in fact, and should have been, about the beginning of the hermeneutics of the self. It is well known that the main objective of the Greek school of philosophy didn't consist of the elaboration and the teaching of a theory. The goal, as you know, was the transformation of the individual, giving to his being a quality which would permit him to live differently, better, more happily than other people. What place did the confession have in this? At first glance, and in all the ancient philosophical practices, the obligation to tell the truth about oneself occupies a rather restrained place. This was for two reasons, both of which remained valid throughout the whole of Greek and Hellenist antiquity. The first of those two reasons is that the objective of philosophical training is to arm the individual with a certain number of precepts which permit him to conduct himself in all circumstances of life without his losing mastery of himself or tranquility of spirit, purity of body or soul, and so on. From this principle stems the importance of the master's discourse. It has to talk, to explain, to persuade. The master has to give the disciple a universal code of conduct for all his life. Thus, the verbalization takes place on the side of the master and not on the side of the disciple. The second reason why the obligation to confess does not have a lot of importance in the direction of antique conscience is that the tie with the master was circumstantial or, in any case, provisional. It is a relationship between two wills, relation which does not imply a complete and definitive obedience. The disciple solicits or accepts the advice of a master or of a friend in order to endure an ordeal, bereavement, an exile, a reverse of fortune, or again, one places oneself under his direction for a certain time of one's life, often, but not necessarily when one is young, so as one day to be able to behave autonomously and no longer have need of advice. Ancient direction tends towards the autonomy of the directed. In these conditions, one can understand that the necessity for exploring oneself in exhaustive depth does not present itself. It is not indispensable to say everything about oneself, to reveal one's least secrets so that the master may exert complete power over one. The exhaustive and continual presentation of oneself under the eyes of an all-powerful director is not an essential feature of these techniques. This technique of direction. But despite this general orientation, which has little emphasis on the confession, one finds, well before Christianity, already elaborated techniques for discovering and formulating the truth about oneself. And their role, it would seem, became more and more important. The growing importance of these techniques is no doubt tied to the development of communal life in the philosophical schools, as with the Pythagoreans and Epicureans. It is also tied to the value accorded to the medical model, either in the Epicurean or in the Stoician philosophy.